professor of saxophone here at UWSP. I have the honor and privilege to introduce this celebration and this concert for you tonight. Tonight we come together to celebrate the 50th anniversary of an ensemble and legacy that Don Green started when he first arrived to UWSP in 1967. The concept of a wind ensemble was still in its infancy, whose genesis was just 15 years earlier at the Eastman School of Music by Frederick Fennell. With the exception of doubling clarinets, Fennell's purpose was to create a wind band that paralleled the orchestral model by having one player per part. The middle half of the 20th century was also extremely important to the development of the repertoire for the modern wind band. Frank Fennell, Frank Battisti, and our own Don Green, and many others, solicited some of the best composers to write for this new medium. As a result, this created new opportunities for color, transparency, and clarity that were not as easily attained by a larger symphonic band. Fennell's creation sparked a revolution in the wind band world, with numerous high school and college bands following suit. The very first ensemble of its kind in the state of Wisconsin, the UWSP Symphonic Wind Ensemble, quickly gained notoriety and was invited to perform at numerous national and international events such as the National MENC Conference on two separate occasions. In 2017, the ensemble was recognized by CBDNA as one of the best small collegiate wind ensembles. Composers such as Aaron Copland, Vincent Persichetti, William Schumann, Vaclav Nellybel, Clifton Williams, Karel Husa, and Joseph Schwander significantly advanced the wind band repertoire in a short amount of time with their harmonic language and new compositional techniques not previously used in the genre. Tonight, we will play tribute to the rich history of this ensemble, the thousands of students that have contributed to its legacy, and the directors that left an indeniable mark by performing some of the most favorite pieces throughout the past 50 years.
Thank you. for the future band and orchestra directors, that instrumental music education curriculum also took a huge positive improvement over my years, and now has a really important peer teaching model going on. And then Jim Arrowwood, who I'm not officially supposed to talk to, I also know that he was the one who got us into the apprentice conductor term, and then having apprentice conductors be a very important part of our whole curriculum, instrumental and choral. And so I taught clarinet for all these years, taught single reeds, started as a theory teacher, ended as a music lit teacher, and also conducted the campus band and university band sometimes, and also occasional student teachers. Additionally, Don Green is, well, he and I are both clarinetists, but also we have quite a an interesting link from some of our past teachers or his past students. But before I talk about that, I want to just talk about briefly a few other really great things about this music department. This is a music department where you don't have to have your doctorate to do really wonderful work, and that's one of the really cool things. Now, I happen to have come here ABD, all but dissertation, and finished my dissertation many years ago, but this is really a wonderful thing about this music department. And so many of these former directors of bands we're going to be talking about didn't get their doctorates, and they are absolutely amazing people and educators. So let me just talk a little bit about Don Green as a music educator. In 1951, he graduated from Mansfield State University in Pennsylvania, and then he was teaching in New York, sort of in the Buffalo area, and so he had, for about 16 years, very distinguished band programs. And then during that time that he was teaching band, wind ensemble, and all those things in New York, he went to Eastman School of Music. Okay, we've heard something about this already today, Eastman School of Music. And he ended up getting his master's degree in music education. And his clarinet teacher there was Stanley Hasty. Stanley Hasty was also my clarinet professor at Eastman when I was there for my master's. And then if you are one thing about clarinetists, you've heard of Elsa Ludwig Gerder. So Elsa Ludwig was a master's and doctoral student of Mr. Hasty, and she was actually the principal clarinetist, the stupendous principal clarinetist of the Eastman Wind Ensemble. And so my degrees, my Michigan State degrees, bachelor's and doctorate, with Elsa as my primary teacher, and then I was fortunate to go to Eastman and study with Mr. Hasty for my master's as well. Anyway, so that's a pretty neat link. And then just one other thing I will say about our links. It turns out that Don Green's very best high school band student in the Buffalo, New York area, Elizabeth Fogel, and she ended up being my teacher when I was a senior in high school out in Arizona. She was out there playing in the Phoenix Symphony, and he had given her all-day Saturday lessons way back then, and then that we didn't even know about each other at that point, but she had done that for me when I was a senior in high school out in Arizona. So Don and I have a strong bond in our clarinet connections, and then also just in our musical connections. So then I want to talk a little bit about Don Schleicher. Don Schleicher went to UWSP for his bachelor's degree, Bachelor of Music Ed, okay? And then he went on to Northwestern University to get his master's, and John Painter was, the person to, the band teaching conductor to study with at that point. And then it turned out Don Schleicher was hired here in 1984 to be director of band, right when I was hired to be clarinet professor. And so Don Schleicher and I were new faculty together, and then he ended up and left for Michigan, and he has gone on and had a really stellar career. He went to Michigan as associate director of band, then he converted to the orchestra, and now for 23 years, Don Schleicher has been a really terrific orchestra director at Illinois. I also happen to know that he's a kid from Ripon, okay, Don Schweiker, kid from Ripon, Wisconsin. And then another thing I think is important for you at all to know is even better than this. Way back when in Point Music Camp, Don Green's conducting class is what inspired Don Schweiker to become a conductor. So that's a really, I think, a really important thing. And Don Schweiker is just an amazing conductor and teacher in person. And with all of these folks, if I can encourage you to look on websites to find out more about them, and then go see them teach and hear them play. Okay, this is enough about that.
Thank you. suggest that he's here at UW Stevens Point, which our next guest conductor insists on pronouncing Stevens Point. And this is from a guy whose last name is Caldwell. Calling Stevens Point, Stevens Point, is grounds for a name change. Something like Called Not So Well. It always struck me as odd that a musician like Brendan, someone whose training is to blend, to play well with others, couldn't figure out how to pronounce the city he lived in. But then I remembered, he's a conductor. He thinks he was put on this earth to tell others how things should go. Brendan came to us from a place he called Minneapolis and quickly made Stevens Point his home. One of the many memories I have of Brendan involved the premiere of a piece he had commissioned me to write for the wind ensemble. Throughout the process, Brendan was very supportive, instructive, and patient, especially when I missed the deadline. The piece was just about under 10 minutes long, and on the eve of the premiere, Brendan's well-thought-out introductory remarks clocked in at just over 15 minutes. Once again, telling the audience how things would go. Now Brendan has moved on to a lovely, strange place called Ohio. And though we don't miss Brendan's mispronunciations or his lengthy ruminations, we are thankful for the years when Stevens Point was the place Mr. Caldwell called home. Please welcome Brendan Caldwell.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening.
Thank you. It's good to be back home. UWSB is always my home. I never go out without my UWSB sweatshirt. My dean asked me if I could please get something Baldwin Wallace. I said no. Got one sweatshirt. When it wears out, I'll get a new one. This one's got 20 more years wear left. So, for those of you who know, who remember my time here, you're the ones getting comfortable in your seats right now. But I'll try not to be too long. I just want to say that this, you know, as I was understanding what this event was, it seemed to be focused a lot on the directors. And I'm honored to be part of that lineage. But I know that it's not the direct, I mean, it's just so much more. And I think about, I just asked myself the question in my remarks, which I'm just improvising, but I asked myself the question that said, who was it that made this great? Who was it? Who were the special people that carried this thing into continued excellence? And there's a number of them, but some of them are here tonight, and I want to just take a moment. The piece I just conducted was by Jim Arrowood, and I mean, it was by Gustav Holst, sorry. In my book, it's by Jim. And on his final concert, Jack Delaney conducted that piece. And used that score, which is right there, which is Jim Arrowood's score is right there. I brought it with me tonight, with Jim's markings. And, you know, when I think about Jim Arrowood, I think about people who not only were conducting an ensemble, but were creating a culture, right? What Don Green did, the best thing Don Green did was hire other people. I mean, he was a great hirer in that, when you hire the right people. And he always seemed to find out the way to hire the next best person. And I think probably his greatest acquisition this whole time was getting David Hastings on this faculty. And what's interesting about that is, see, Jim had a particular role in my life. You see, everyone comes backstage and says, oh my God, that concert was great. And you always need someone in your life to look at you and go, it was good. But we know the difference between good and great, don't we, little buddy? Make the next one better. And the way that Jim told this to me was by how long he hugged me after the concert. But it was a hug and it was like squeeze, and I tried to let go, and he was like, nope, get back here, young man. On the other hand, there were a few concerts that were like, good job. And so when Jim died, I had a void in my life because I just needed someone. My parents aren't able to come to concerts and our family and stuff, so it was just David Hastings, and Dave took over that role, and he knew we did it. We never shared a sentence about it, but I knew you knew that you were doing that role. And he would hold me as a way of saying, good job, brother. And it's not just David. I mean, you think about the contributions Slugberger Rosen did on every search that I can imagine, and just the way that you serve this department is just extraordinary. And I also want to say one thing to Lucy Thayer. As a conductor, what you really hope for is to have a colleague that you can learn from, and Lucy Thayer is such a monster conductor. She's so good. She programs so well that every one of her concerts goes by in a blink. It always flows right. And she's such a gorgeous conductor, and no matter what she does, her work is just excellent. And to be in a place where I can be like, well, I'm going to try to see if I can look like that. So I want to thank Lucy Thayer if you're here. Lucy. But the man of the hour is Don Green, and this is what I want to say about Don. He was a high school band director. This is a story for everybody. You guys paying attention to this one? This one really matters, actually. It's not that funny, but it matters. Don was a high school band director, and he spoke to his board, his school board, about getting some sort of money for something, right? Probably a commission from Carl Husser or something. I don't know what he was fundraising for. And he asked them for money, and he did such a great job of selling it, right? And the school board was like, heck yes, we'll definitely do this. Way to go. Yes, absolutely. And they signed him up. And then one guy goes, hey, come over here, young man. I own a car dealership. And if you're not working in the summer, I want you to sell cars for me. And everyone thought, oh my God, Don Green at a car lot? Like, watch out, Ford. Forget the Japanese. Don Green's coming. But what happened was, Don Green never sold a car. Not one lousy car. He didn't get paid for anything for 2 months worth of work because he never sold a darn car. And it ends up he's not a great salesman. He's a great musician. And the difference is, you can get him talking about music and he'll talk forever. But about cars or something he doesn't care about, it's hard for him. And I think it's important to differentiate between the fact that Don Green is an amazing salesperson when it comes to what he loves. But what's more important to take away from Don Green is that he always did what he loved. That's the lesson. Don't learn how to be a salesperson as good as he is. Learn how to pick a career where you're going to see this man tonight conduct, and he has still got it. It's like a textbook video for how to conduct Star Trek. He's still got it because it's in his DNA. It's still there. It doesn't ever go away. He's conducted that piece a bajillion times, and it never goes away because he's a great musician. So let's all take this moment, please, and honor the legacy of Don Green. Let me just say this in closing. Jerry Merriwood isn't here in person. There's a number of band directors that couldn't be here tonight, right? Jim Merriwood is not one of them. Jim Merriwood's here tonight. He'll always be here. It gets in the walls like mold, only good mold. And Jim Merriwood is always here, and I knew that Jim's conducting days were coming to an end. So what I wanted to do was a big thing for Jim. And so this is the story that, by the way, everyone in America knows the story except for those people in the audience. So get ready, because when you go out to the college universe, they all know the story because Greg Kirchhoff tells it everywhere he goes. And that is that Jim Merriwood taught me a very important lesson when I was young. And that is that if you're wearing a tuxedo, always wear black underwear. Just in case you forget to zip your zipper up. And he was over here on this day where he conducted, he conducted the Hooligans March that you just heard Michael Butler wonderfully do with this ensemble a couple of minutes ago. And the Hooligans March is like a heavy lift. It's a heavy lift of a piece. Like, I would have to eat my Wheaties if I was gonna do that piece, right? And Jim wanted to do it. It was his favorite piece. So we practiced, but the thing he was most nervous about was that he had to buy this like 100-foot cord for his oxygen tank, which was back here. He didn't want anyone to see his oxygen tank. He had a mask and he was breathing. You couldn't take him to hibachi because it would light on fire. And it was an oxygen tank, and he was just so worried that that's what the audience was going to see, that he came time and time again, and we taped it down here along the thing, and it came up there, and it went through his zipper. And then up his shirt and then to his mouth. And he got up here and I said, are you ready to go, maestro? And he said, yes, just give me a second. He knew it was his last time really conducting. And I wanted to give him the space. We had a chair there for him. And he climbed up here slowly and he got his way, he had a chair. And when he got up there, he still had to catch his breath. He had to sit on the chair for just a little bit to catch his breath. Then he stood up and then he looked down and he realized that his zipper was down. So he had to do this move where he was trying to look like a conductor as possible while simultaneously zipping up his zipper. No one knows that part of the story, but that's true. So then Craig, who's my teacher and his best friend and the dearest friend of all the Merriwoods that grew up together, my teacher, he's about 5 foot nothing, right here, he comes up to about here on me. I wanted my friend to see his person and his student on his last concert. So Jim starts conducting and he begins it so beautifully. And Craig, who, like I said, he's like, I could put my drink on his head. He's in front of me so he can see perfectly. Oh, I'm right over Craig's head. And we're watching him.
and this wonderful thing happened. Jim knew it was his last time conducting, and right in the first third of the piece, he turned to his buddy Craig and his successor Brendan, and he gave me a thumbs up. That he was okay. That it was all good. And he was in his happy place. And right at that moment, Craig turned to me with this twinkle in his eye, like, "I'm proud of you, student. This was part of the gig. Yeah, take care of Jim while you're here. I'm proud of you. Thank you." This twinkle I'll never forget. So he turns back to Jim and he gives him a thumbs up, and they share that moment. It was wonderful. And then the piece kept going, and Jim gave him another thumbs up. Like, "Way to go, this is really awesome." And Craig comes back, "Way to go, buddy, we're all with you." And then the last end of the piece happens, and he cuts the band off, and he goes over to the piccolo and grabs the piccolo and whispers something in her ear, and he comes off here, and I turn the tank on, and he breaks his way off the stage, and he sits down, and he says, "Next time I give you the thumbs up, turn on the goddamn oxygen tank." And he didn't let it go either. It was like 45 seconds later, and I thought he was calming down because he caught his breath, and I hear him go, "Son of a bitch, give him one time." That part was editorialized. So listen, I just want to say that for everyone who couldn't make it today, be they people who are with us or not with us, Jim Arrowood is always somebody who will be the heart and soul of this place, and Don Green, you guys built this place, and this next tune, which is a southern folk tune that was near and dear to Jim's heart, this one's for the one who couldn't be here but is here.
Thank you.
when Michael asked me to share a favorite memory of Mary, I'm in all honesty dedication, every single memory I have is my favorite. So I will pick just four of them. First of all, when I came off the airplane from my interview, he was the first person I met. And from that point on, he became my mentor. We got in the car, and he just started talking about what this is about. Teaching and learning. And it was, and he still is my mentor. He will always be my mentor. The second memory was when we had Larry Livingston here as a guest. An extraordinary conductor, musician, and administrator. And Larry worked with all the groups here. And Jim didn't sit in the, while the rehearsal was going, he didn't sit in the room here. He got his clarinet out and got in the band and participated. Hmm. So that was a lesson, you know, he taught me many lessons, and that was another one. That he just didn't sit idly back and watch another person work with his group. He became part of the experience. Another one was I visited him up in the hospital. And I walked into the room, and this poor fellow had a tube coming out of everything you can imagine. And he looks at me and he goes, "How are you?" So here I'm coming to see him, and he's not in great shape, but he's always was always concerned about me. He gave me books, he gave me recordings, and we just had this wonderful relationship of just talking about teaching and learning. And one final thing is, and I think some of us have know these words, and I have it posted in my studio. And one thing that he always said to his groups is, never play louder than lovely. And so that's something that I want to finish with, because that's it's a metaphor for us all, I think, in life, but also it's something that I carry with me in my heart forever. So here's to Jim Irwin.
Some of the wind ensemble directors being remembered tonight have one leg squarely in the jazz world and one leg in the concert wind band world. Of course, Don Green is the quintessential example of that, starting the wind ensemble here and the stage band, which would become the jazz ensemble in 1968. Brendan Caldwell also seemed to me to always have a secret desire to program more repertoire of that swamp. I'm not sure that we can say the same for Scott Tiedemann. And Scott, if you're watching this at home, I love you. There's a camera right there. So Scott directed the UW Stevens Point Wind Bands from 2001 to 2006 before taking the job at UW-Madison. I'll never forget my excitement in sharing with Scott a recording of Grammy Award-winning jazz vocalist Kurt Elling in advance of Mr. Elling's appearance at the Jazz Festival in 2003. After a few days, I asked Scott Teeple what he thought of the recording. And the only thing he said in his sincere yet vaguely superior way was, "Does he always sing out of tune?" Jazz Ensemble and Wind Ensembles had both been invited to the state convention, the Jazz Ensemble for a featured performance. And the Wind Ensemble was to serve as a demonstration group for a conducting masterclass by H. Robert Reynolds. It was a wonderful tour, and many of those students on that tour have gone on to great things, people like Marlon McKay, who is now professor of music in Kentucky, Brian Bisak, who's professor of music in Oregon, Danny Mitchell, who I think whose name we all are familiar with, and guess who else was on that tour as a student? Our own Professor Dave Story was on that tour. Anyway, after marveling at Scott's conducting that, I got to see him conduct the same piece over and over again. I asked him how he created such a remarkable rapport with his ensemble, and his answer forever changed my own approach to leading ensembles. He simply said, "Trust them."
Thank you.
And then after two wonderful years here, it turned out that the University of Michigan stole Don Schleicher. H. Robert Reynolds was here as a guest conductor and saw the quality of Don Schleicher's work and took him away to the University of Michigan as an associate director of bands. And so then the next fine director of bands we got to work with was Dennis Locke. And Dennis Locke is also a Wisconsin kid, okay? He's just from up the road in Clintonville. In fact, his dad used to be the janitor at the high school. And Dennis Locke had done his bachelor's degree down at UW-Madison and with the old H. Robert Reynolds. And then also Dennis Locke went to Northwestern and studied with the same mentor that Don Schleicher had, John Painter. Dennis Locke was teaching public school band in the Oconomowoc School District when we got him to come to school here. And I think he was on our staff for 4 years, and then by golly, H. Robert Reynolds took him to Michigan too, because it turns out Don Schleicher had switched over to orchestra. One additional quick thing I want to say about Don Schleicher is he is now, if you want to get him in front of an elementary band, an elementary orchestra, or all the way up to professionals, he's your man. I mean, incredible.
Incredible.
Conductor and look forward with those folks. Dennis Locke, just a also a clarinetist, okay, also a terrific musician, teacher, and conductor, and again from Wisconsin. He went. Dennis Locke was taken to the University of Michigan as associate director of bands, and then Dennis has been for quite a number of years director of concert band at Penn State University. He actually conducted the Wisconsin Honor Band a few years ago. Grandma was part of that, and probably some of the rest of the work. Actually, just as far as Wisconsin public school music educators go, Dennis's wife, Jane, wonderful bassoonist, but her professional work has been in choral conducting and elementary music ed and those kinds of things. So if you want to get a really great instrumental and vocal conductor and teacher duo, it would be Jane and Dennis Locke. So both are now at Penn State. Anyway, and then the other Michigan connection is our predecessor to Dr. Butler, and that is Jonathan Caldwell. John was here for 1 year as director of bands, and since that time he's been teaching and conducting down at Virginia Tech. And I got to know him and his work under emergency situations. It turned out the first three concerts of the Wind Ensemble that year, I had to be as the substitute in the clarinet section. So the October concert, the principal clarinetist was ill, and so I got to sight read the concert. So my eyes were wide open. And then the December concert I had a little bit more notice, not principal, but one of the really challenging pieces and cool pieces for that concert was Dr. Young's flute concerto, and then Tara Swag was our soloist, and there were many lighting effects and so forth. So that was quite an exciting experience. Also, the Wind Ensemble was invited to play a special concert in the January of that year for the Wisconsin chapter of the National Band Association. And so it turns out that particular semester, my two co-principal clarinets had gone off to student team, so I got to play again. But it was really great because I thought he was a wonderful musician and conductor, and I really liked his approach. He came to us, John Caldwell, with a newly minted doctorate from Michigan, and his mentor was James Haycock. No, James.
Michael
Haycock. Right. Okay. If you have more questions. Yeah.
touches the heart deeply. And it's an experience that I know that I'll never forget. And I think the students that were in the ensemble certainly will remember that forever. I'm immensely proud of these students and all of the students that have come through this ensemble and the entire program. And honestly, we can't do it without all of our outstanding colleagues that we have. So let's give a round of applause for the outstanding artists, faculty, teachers.
Exactly the same. Recreation and recreation. meetings, same spelling, recreation, or recreation and recreation, which is what they do. And I want to thank them for all they do. These students have been wonderful. And we enjoyed the concert tonight. I want to thank you all for coming. And I also want to thank the audiences we get here, because we have, you folks are wonderful too, because you're the ones that come and support it and appreciate it, and you deserve it a lot. Students followed me from my high school and high schools in the area around Buffalo that I knew. And anyway, it's great. And I thank you all for your attendance and your applause and everything else. Thank you. We'll be right back.
wanted also to thank Michael and the staff, faculty here, for all the work and effort they put into creating this 50th anniversary concert. And I didn't realize until last week, it was the same exact date, the 22nd. How can you do better than that? Anyway, thank you very much.